Welcome to the Foreign Correspondents Club of Japan. My name is Michael Penn. I'm the first vice president of the club, and I will be your moderator for today. This is the fifth in our series of theoretically monthly political roundtables in which we have a chance to cross-examine in somewhat more depth than usual an English-speaking politician. And today, in fact, we have the special privilege, I think, yes, the first time, to have a party leader with us at this event. So Mr. Keiichiro Asao, who's sitting next to me, is quite an experienced member of the Diet. He was for some time a member of the Democratic Party of Japan, but unlike most Democratic Party of Japan members, he left the party just before they entered the government. So although he was likely on track to be a foreign minister or defense minister, he decided to go to another party, which at that time was Mina no To, your party. And your party, he was basically sort of in the number three position for quite some time, but then the party sort of imploded, and especially the party's founder, Mr. Watanabe, had a scandal, which is one of the issues we'll probably talk about today, and Mr. Asao became the leader of Mina no To. But then Mina no To itself had continuing problems, probably hangover from Mr. Watanabe's scandal. And now he's the head of a political party whose Japanese name I know, but I've never heard the English name. Mina no Kaikaku. What is the official English name of Mina no Kaikaku?
I haven't made a translation of the Mina no Kaikaku, so there's no official translation.
So if I want to designate it in my articles in English, what should I do?
Well, you can say, I'll think about that.
Because I would like to write about you from time to time.
Okay. You're a reformist party.
A reformist party or something like this. But anyway, it is a regional party based in Kanagawa Prefecture. And not only does it have, what is it, two national lawmakers?
Yes. Uh-huh.
And then also a number of local lawmakers as well. And I believe you just signed some sort of agreement with the Nagoya-based Genzei Nippon, right? Uh-huh. So trying to make a federation of local parties. So before we get into the meat here, let me explain to you what is different about the round table as opposed to our normal press conferences here at the FCCJ. In the case of a round table, this is not simply he gives a presentation, and then those of us ask him questions for the remaining time. This is interactive. So that means we want to hear your opinions as well as your questions. It's meant to be a really back and forth event. So it's a chance to kind of get more into the meat of issues, to hear what you have to say as well as what he has to say, and to try to learn more. And it's a political roundtable, so what we really want to know here more is to understand Japanese politics better. We'll go on for about an hour, and then we'll have a 5-minute break, and then we'll continue for another hour. It's also a chance for you to exchange meishis with him and with each other, so it's also meant to be a networking event, so please take advantage of the opportunity. Well, let me pose sort of the first question to our guest, which is kind of, I guess, a simple question, but sometimes it's the simple things that we don't know because it's not in the media. If someone is a young politician who wants to be a politician and they want to, you know, they've gotten out of university and they said, okay, I want to be a politician, how do they go about getting involved in politics? Do they first sign up with a party? How do they get supporters? How do they get money? What's the standard way for someone to get involved in politics in Japan?
Well, that's a very good question. because I think there's no set rules to become a politician in Japan. And also, I think this is true for many countries. You can visit a party that has a policy that is close to your ideal, or you can run for a local assembly without belonging to any party, but making your own point. Recently, we just had this election in many local assemblies in the Toitsu Chihou Senkyo, which probably if you live in, most of you here live in Tokyo. I'm sure during the second half of April, please have a seat wherever you would like to. You've heard many cars with speakerphones with someone speaking on that car. Of course, if you are one condition that that has to be matched, that is, even if you're out of college or if you're not out of college, you have to be over 25 years old to run for a local assembly or national assembly in the lower house. To run for the upper house or to run for a governor's seat, you have to be over 30 years old. You can be a mayor or a local assembly member, or you can be a member of the lower house if you're over 25. So one way is to set your own agenda in that city or whatever, and run for the local assembly. If the goal is to become a politician, or if the goal is to become a politician and have a seat in whatever, and I'm not saying that this is a bad way, because usually the agenda that these persons sets may not be workable, but it is likely in the recent area that you will be elected if you're young and energetic, because many people in Japan, especially people living in the urban area, are not aligned to any major national parties. And if you, whatever you say is, gets across in the cities or towns that you live, then the chances that you may be elected. Oh, okay, one other rule is that you have to live in that town for or city for at least 3 months to run for a local assembly. Or if you have to live in that prefecture, prefectural level of local assembly as well. I mean, prefectural assembly. For the prefecture, you don't have to live in the electoral district, but you have to live in that prefecture. In other words, yeah, if you don't live in that electoral district, you can't vote for you can't write your own name, but you can run for the seat in the prefectural level. So those are tiny things. But again, one way is to run for a local assembly with your own sets of agenda. And the good thing about that is that if you're elected, then you will be paid for 4 years. And there usually local assemblies is not dissolved, so you have a fixed amount of money for 4 years. And
about, I mean, is it enough to live on?
Yeah, of course. I mean, usually you're paid. It depends on how big the city, how wealthy the city towns are. But if you are, you know, talking about a city like my hometown Kamakura, they would earn 8 million yen per year. And on top of that, I think they will have 50,000 yen per month for political spendings. But I think, to be frank, what is more, it's more generous in the 23 Nijusanku, in the Tokyo metropolitan area, because the annual salary probably would be slightly more, like 10 million yen per year, but the annual monthly stipend, or monthly whatever you call it, for these fixed amount of payment that you can use for your political activities is probably like 400,000 yen per month. And it was in the Nijusanku, Tokyo 23 wards.
And my understanding is national lawmakers also get salaries for a secretary?
Yes, but the local assembly members don't.
Right.
So usually they don't have a secretary. But you know, if you are, again, assembly member at the prefectural level, the monthly payment for your political activities is more than, usually more than 500,000 yen. So you can use that money for to finance your own secretary or whatever. And so to begin with, if you're young and you would like to become some sort of involved in the politics, one way is that to run for a local assembly, either with a under the brand name of national or local political parties, or run as an independent with your own agenda, whichever. The likelihood of you being elected depends on what you say, rather than which party you belong to. So that's one way. And the other way, okay, you can say whatever. Just let me just finish. The other way is to visit, again, a national party or local party that you think is close to your own ideal. And you can either work for that party for some years, or if you're elected, the party members will ask you to run for national election as well.
Okay. Yeah. Go ahead. By the way, first of all, introduce yourself.
My name is Vishwa Ghosh. I actually am not even related to journalism and corporate person, but I am interested in the topic that is on the table today. I guess a follow-up question to Michael's question.
Because I think they're recording, they might want you to use the microphone.
Yeah, okay.
You can typically, not so many in the real small towns, but if you are talking about cities like big cities like Yokohama, many members of particularly LDP local assembly person are whose father or mother used to be a local assembly member at that city.
So corollary to that question is then, since you stand for reformism in politics, do you expect reforms to actually come about in Japan? Because if politics runs in the family, people will simply follow their father's footsteps.
Well, even if it follows in the, I mean, to answer your question, I think the reform usually, well, no, I shouldn't say usually. Even if it's many members are from family background, has that background. If the voters sense the need for reform, I think the reform would happen. One example that I can give you is that in Osaka, the Restoration Party, many members of Restoration Party are whose father or mother, or basically whose father, was a local assembly member. They were from LDP. For one example that I can give you is that I think the Governor Matsui of Osaka, his father was a local assembly member, and he is a second generation member in that case, and at least. The National Japan Restoration Party is saying that they are reformist, and I think the voters would view them as a reformist as well, and therefore, to answer your question, even if they are from political background, if they sense that it is better for their own election to say that I will change this, and I'm not saying that the Restoration Party are saying that they will change many things. The biggest thing is that they would destroy Osaka City. That is a reform or revolution. Whether the outcome is good or bad, it's the people of the Osaka to decide. But I don't think anyone here would say that it's not you know, following a conservative thing because of the family background.
Okay. So I want to move forward a little bit on political funding. So far you've said that one of the basic sources, especially for starting lawmakers or starting assembly people, is the salary they receive and the support, basically the public support. Now I've also heard there's things called koenkais, and there's also something I've heard about parties to which people buy tickets or something like this. So what are the other common sources of funding for a politician?
Well, I think the funding sources that is that exists in Japan probably exists in the United States. To the extent that the limitation may be different, and I would say that the total amount of political funding in the United States is much bigger compared to that in Japan, and the reason behind that is that in the United States, each individual candidate can make his or her own TV commercial, which makes the need, if you're running for a Senate seat in California, it would probably cost, the funding cost alone would be more than $30 million or so. Okay, having said that, of course, each candidate can ask for a donation. That's the basic thing. Either individual, donation from individual, or if you belong to a national party, you could have a donation from corporates or organizations. Not just corporations, unions can make donations to political parties, but they cannot give donations to individuals. Unions or corporates or NGOs can make donations to national party members. So the donation is one source, and you can divide donation to either it's from individual or from corporates. Secondly, you can have parties. You can have your political parties, political events, I should say. So if I say parties, you might be confused with political events, whereby you can just give someone water and charge you 20,000 yen or whatever. It's up to you. I mean, political the constitution allows everyone to have freedom in political activity, which means that you can charge whatever amount that for a cup of water. That's not, I mean, unconstitutional. I mean, if you say that it's not legal, then saying that is unconstitutional. But anyways, political events is the second sort. In case of political events, anyone can have a political event, and also anyone can attend or buy tickets to these political events. Even corporates can buy tickets. So those are the two. I can go into the details of that if you want to. But thirdly, you can have funding from funds given from the party. The party may give you some fundings. The parties would receive funds from mainly from taxpayers' money, because there's this law that says the total population Japanese citizens you times that with 250 yen, and that will be budgeted each year, and the amount will be distributed to parties, and if parties like Communist Party says they are not going to receive these funds, then it is not returned to the government, but whatever amount that Communist Party refused to receive will be distributed among the rest of the party, the rest of the parties. That means that the Communist Party says that we are the ones that are not receiving these funds, but since they are not receiving, LDP and DPJ are receiving more than that they are allocated to. That is the third source of fundings. or the you can you meaning the political committees. It's not no. It is something like PACs, but it's slightly different. But the political, I should say, organization that you file to either prefecture or national level. If you file whatever political organization, these organizations could actually engage in economic activities. For instance, they could ask corporations to put an ad on your flyer, and you can receive funds from that. So those are probably the sources.
Okay. Yes, please introduce yourself.
Chris Winkler, Senior Research Fellow from the German Institute for Japanese Studies. I have one question. If I remember correctly, you were first elected to the upper house in 98.
Yeah.
So maybe not from your personal experiences, but one reason to introduce the SMD and to do electoral reform in the 1990s, right, was to cut the need for external funding.
SMD is single member district.
Sorry. So to do away with the clientelism, cronyism of the LDP, Zokugin, tribesmen, etc. From your perspective, has that actually happened? Or has the system not have the desired effect?
You mean, has SMB, single member district, has it made the cost for running for election cheaper? Is that your question, or including that?
Including that, and then of course, by strengthening party headquarters powers here in Tokyo and reducing, for instance, influence of the factions, has that sort of given basically parties more leeway in distributing funds to individual members and then doing away with the need for individual members to run around in their districts collecting money?
The first part is true. I mean, the parties probably would, because a single member district was introduced in Thai with the Seito Kofukin. What's the translation of that?
Probably political funding support or something.
Which is the taxpayers' money that I have just talked about.
Yeah, it's called a political subsidy law. Yeah, maybe. Yeah.
Okay, so. Not just the single member district increased the power of the headquarters of the national parties, but it has introduced in conjunction with introducing the political subsidy law, which gives a party each year, like probably LDP would receive, I don't know, 10 billion yen annually, which is quite big money. Again, because Communist Party don't receive their allowed 2 billion yen or so, that will be distributed among the parties. Anyways, because of the fact that the national headquarters receive these funds, they can distribute funds to their members or candidates in the district, in each district, which gave power to the headquarters. To answer the second part, has it made it easier for candidates to run for, because he or she don't have to seek for the funding that was needed before this was introduced. And to answer that question, I think yes, but that did not totally relieve the candidate from raising funds. I mean, in other words, the funds that are given by the national headquarters alone does not supply the total amount needed in general to be elected. So you would have to generate funds on top of the funds that you receive from the national headquarters.
Anybody else want to jump in at this point? Okay, somebody give a microphone to Stefano. Over here, Daniel has one.
My name is... I'm Stefano Carrea for the Italian Economic Daily. It's difficult for foreign journalists to assess when so-called scandals surfaced in political funding. It's difficult for us to assess how serious they are and if the very fact that the scandal surfaces maybe have some hidden implications or so on. For instance, in my country appeared very trivial, like the female minister of justice, that was the issue of the distribution of funds free of charge to the. But there were some much more serious cases, like the one involving the criminal investigation of Ozawa. Or also for Atoyama. For instance, I remember that a member of the Italian embassy told me, well, maybe I could be involved in a political scandal because he just went to, out of curiosity, to a political event. So actually he bought a ticket. So if Atoyama was accused because, I remember, maybe a restaurant owner with a Japanese name was actually Korean, and so foreigners were financing Japanese politicians and so on. So my question is, when scandals, when there is an event of scandal or so on, give us some comments to help us to assess how to judge these events.
Well, to attend a political event, because of the fact that it is a political event, so you're attending this political event, and the fee, again, can be charged at whoever is hosting that event's will, at his or her own will. And therefore, in other words, you're paying a fee to enter that place. And since you're paying a fee, it is regarded as not a donation. And therefore, since it's not a donation, even if you're not a Japanese national, you can attend a political event. So I would welcome all of you to pay 20,000 yen whenever I host a political event. It's legal. But you can't donate. If you're ethnic Korean living in Japan for a long time, or if you're third generation, even whatever, if you're fifth generation, if you don't have a Japanese nationality, you cannot make a donation. And what's the difference? The difference is that attending a political event is you're paying a fee for a service, even if it's a cup of water. People may say a cup of water for 20,000 yen is expensive, but who cares? I mean, you agreed to pay for this 20,000 yen. But donation, you don't get anything for in return. Therefore, you would have to be a Japanese national. And under my understanding, I think it is similar, but somewhat different in the United States. They have a political dinner. From what I sense, if someone knows,
we don't know. We're in Japan.
I mean, they may charge $100,000 for a one night dinner event, but I think if it's over a certain amount, you have to be U.S. national, U.S. citizen, but if it's under a certain amount, then non-American citizens can attend. So in that sense, I think it's a little bit similar.
So follow-up question.
Mike, please.
Can corporations make a donation? And is there a separation between Japanese corporations versus foreign?
A donation. Corporations can only make a corporation. I think it was, they've changed the laws, I'm not really sure, but it has to be more than 50% owned by a Japanese national. But they've slightly changed for listed companies in the Tokyo Stock Exchange. I haven't followed, but donations has to be made to national parties or branches of national parties. They cannot make to individuals. But corporations can make, and the reason why they've changed this law is because, for instance, companies like Canon, which probably all of you, Nissan, probably you might not think that it's a Japanese company, but Canon, I think all of you would think that it's a Japanese company, but it's, I think it's more the shareholders of Canon is more than 50%, or occasionally it becomes more than 50% owned by foreign funds. Or pension funds, things like that, and therefore they were not allowed to give donations. So they used Canon Marketing, their subsidiary, to give donations. But that's not really. I mean, people would think that Canon would be a Japanese company, and therefore they've changed the law. So if it's listed in Tokyo Stock Exchange, they can make donations. But that's a trivial one. I mean. They can make donations.
I'm Daniel Eskenazi, a freelance journalist from Switzerland. You said, okay, donations are for free, of course, but does it give you a special access to the politician to lobby in some activities or, what does a donation give you as a...
That's a very good question. Very good point. Okay, let me give you a good example to that, or a good my way of thinking to that. Corporations can make donations, but corporations have shareholders. Would shareholders are shareholders willing to give their own money, because donations have to be made out of profit. So are they happy to see their own money being used without any return? Probably not. But they can make donations. On the other hand, if the return is more than access, then it's a scandal or it could be a crime. For instance,
like the recruit scandal or something from the 90s.
Yeah, or. Oh yeah, recruit scandal is that's a very difficult example because I don't know what they really wanted to make out of, and this was not a donation, by the way. I mean, they were giving their stocks. So,
Senecom?
Even if the donation is listed on and filed, donations as a legal donation has to be filed. I mean, it has to be reported if it's more than 50,000 yen. So even if it's filed, if the company or individual asks for more than a access, then it could be a crime. The other way to answer this question is that because of the fact that there's this criticism from some of the shareholders some of the utility companies, or most of the utility companies, don't make any donations by themselves. They ask their executives to give individual donation at, you know, it's been reported sometimes that whatever utility company has made, their directors have made 100,000 yen or a 1 million yen donation at the same date, which is legal, of course. I mean, if they made it out of their own will, each and every director has suddenly decided to want to give some 1 million yen to this utility company, that's perfectly legal. But people would think that, well, why would they make donations at the same day? But to answer your question, aren't they buying an access? Yes, because otherwise it won't be justified to their shareholders. But you have to be careful, because if you're more than buying an access, then that will be seen as a bribe.
That's an interesting question. We're talking about corporations now. My understanding is that on a party basis, by far, something, I don't know, 80, 90% goes to the LDP, and that only a very small proportion goes to the other parties, and that, for example, Rengo is well known to be the main supporter of the DPJ. So what's your understanding about the balance of power, shall we say, from both corporations and labor unions as far as their support to the various political parties goes?
Well, I mean, in terms of amount?
Percentage, or what's your understanding of where those donations are going?
Well, I think in terms of amount, I mean, corporations give much more money than unions to begin with. And, the LDP receives most of the corporate donations, and therefore they receive more donations compared to DPJ. On the other hand, the unions provide labor force at electoral campaigns. So if you calculate the value of the personnel sent to your campaign office from the unions, the amount might become closer.
And other than the corporations, the big business corporations and the labor unions, is there any other interest group, organized interest group, that are sort of on the radar of politicians?
I don't know whether you call it an interest group, but some of the religious groups are very active in political campaigns. Other than that, I think the interest groups, typically, if you look at major donations or funds, are from, Doctors Union or Doctors Federation, Dentist Federation, whoever runs who's a real estate dealers association, they are good big supporters of and they give out quite some amount of money.
Okay, first Daniel, then back to Chris.
Could you, in this context, can you give us a few details about Keidanren, for example? Do they give money to LDP, for example?
Keidanren used to ask their member corporations to give donations, but they have stopped that custom for a long time. But now they have started. They said that they will restart donations to LDP. But this really doesn't have any meaning, because even though Keidanren stopped giving money to political parties, Japanese Automobile Manufacturing Association, which is consisted of Toyota, Nissan, Honda, whatever. Nissan, by the way, for a long time could not give donations because they were regarded as a foreign company. Toyota and Honda and Suzuki gave money to LDP under the name of Nihon Jidosha Kogyokai. And Toyota also has made their donation to LDP as well. Therefore,
By the way, that would be something like the Japanese Auto Industry Association,
yes,
or something.
Exactly.
Like
this. So what I'm saying is that even though Keidanren has stopped giving donations to LDP, and they have said that they will restart this custom. During the period of that Keidanren has been stopping giving donations, the Japanese Automobile Manufacturing Industry Association is part of Keidanren, or you can regard that as a big chunk of Keidanren. The Japanese Steel Association is also a big chunk of Keidanren. Association is also a big chunk of Keidanren. And pharmaceuticals, whatever, is also a chunk of Keidanren. Each and probably every industry association has been giving donations, except for the electrical companies. The utility companies have said that they will not give donations by their names.
Chris?
One question, since we are talking about corporate donations. There has been for a long, long time in the Diet discussions whether to prohibit corporations from giving donations to politicians. What's your stance on that? Do you think it should be outlawed strictly or more limitations put in place? I mean, we are seeing with the utilities as you just described. I mean, there have been lots of loopholes still.
Yeah, there are a lot of loopholes. I mean, if you if you prohibit corporations to give donations, probably some corporations would give their executives more salary and ask them to give donations on April the 1st or 2nd. So just prohibiting donations from Keidanren is just making another loophole. So, I mean, what are the difference? I mean, if the funding of donation comes from your company, then that you work for, then it's the same. And would the donations from owners of corporations, are they all clean? I don't know. Maybe not.
Related to that, what do you make of the recent proposals by Ishin Noto, Japan Innovation Party is their English name now. They've
changed from Restoration to Innovation?
Yes, they're at the national level, yes.
Okay,
they're at the local level, the Osaka Restoration Association, but their national name is Japan Innovation Party.
Is
your colleague, Kenji Ada, at work. You know, he's changing names.
Okay.
They have proposed, and they've tried to make a big splash in the media about banning corporate donations. What's your view of that? Is it just a gimmick, or is there a real political reform movement going on there?
No. Again, I mean, if they are really serious about corporate influence, they should, at the same time, ban donations from executives of that corporations, and also they should ban corporations from buying event tickets. The Japan Innovation Party is not innovative enough to ban the corporations to buying event tickets, and therefore it's just the just an appeal.
And by the same token, it seems to most people that the one party that's very, very consistent is the Japan Communist Party. You know, they seem to be, from some people's perspective, almost the only honest party when it comes to these issues. Or do you see it differently?
Well, they receive donations from individuals. And also they sell the red flag, or Akahata, newspaper. And the first part. they receive donations from individuals. That's okay. I mean, but you would have to seriously look at the who are the ones that are donating to the Communist Party. I don't know, but a lot of maybe 30% or so comes from their own members of the Diet or members of the Assembly. In other words, the Communist Party as a whole work for you to be elected, but they cut 30% off your salary. Is that honest or not? It's up to the people to decide. The rest, the other part, I mean, is from donations from the individual that that share the ideal with the Communist Party. So that's okay. I mean, but again, you can't really differentiate each and every donation, because I mean, members of the parliament or members of the assembly or political members may be able to differentiate this donation from this donation, whether it has a tie or not. But if you're an outsider, there's no way that you know. I mean, you can always argue that you know, he or she was generous enough to give donations. And therefore, my point is that. And again, you can, even if you ban donations, you can buy event tickets. So it's again, you have to you, meaning the voters, have to live with that. I mean,
And just to complete the circle before I move to your question, Kometo, is their model of financing different from the other parties, or is it pretty much the same? In your understanding, obviously, you're not a member of the party.
Well, I think I know that many members of Kometo receive donations, and they occasionally some members of the Diet, and also in some cases some members of the local assembly host an event where they sell tickets, and therefore it in ways they are similar to other parties.
Okay, I saw yes.
In Japan, do you have lobbyists like you have in the U.S. Pushing for agenda? And at a more general level, what are your views on corporations using their financial muscle power to influence policies?
We don't have, for instance, we don't have the system of registered lobbyists that in the United States, we don't have that. And also, there are certain consulting firms, but there are much less of those kind of firms in Japan. The reason behind that, in some cases, and not really now, but say 20 years ago, or even back, or more back before, I think the. I would say that a lot of the jobs of the executives of the major Japanese corporations themselves were being a lobbyist, asking for a legal structure that is favorable to their industry. But that has been changed dramatically. The reason behind that is that many of the Japanese corporations are now, their at least sales volume is much bigger outside of Japan than in Japan, and therefore, if you are in the business for a long time, the need for change in for the system or legal structure is much less, and therefore, I don't think the responsibility of the Japanese corporations now, or the executives, are as big in that field, except for some of the highly regulated industries. And the example of highly regulated industries is the utility companies. And I would believe that is why their executives, not just the electrical companies, but the telecommunications companies also, give donations under the name of the directors. And what was the other part?
The second one, your personal views on
and the muscle. I think the corporate muscle is much less now, because the corporates themselves are not relying on the Japanese political system. They don't have that much of a need as before.
Except for the nuclear lobbies?
Yes, but I think the public, if you take a poll, I would say more than 50% would agree to that eventually we would fade out of the nuclear power plant. If I said that I will stop nuclear power plant tomorrow as a prime minister, then the poll would be maybe 50-50. But if I said that I will make a plan so that we will not be relying on nuclear power 30 years from now, I would say, I don't know, 90% of the public would say, yes, I would agree to. So even if they are very active financially, their political power is not that strong, I would say.
Anybody?
Isn't it humiliating for employees to realize that the company they are a member of is giving money to a specific party? I mean, if I am an employee of a company, but if I knew that my company give money to a specific party, any party, I will feel frustrated, angry, and upset, actually. So, I mean, this issue was never raised. I mean, no employees of any company has ever raised the issue of why my company should give money to this party instead of another party. So.
I don't know. Of course, it probably has been raised occasionally, but probably the company would say that at least before 1989, the company would say that this is a cost for a free world, free trade world, or free. I mean, they are supporting LDP because there's a Cold War, and the Supreme Court of Japan would say that, okay, that's the company being a member of the society as well, they can act as a natural person, and therefore if the cause for giving donations is constitutional, it has been ruled. But after the Cold War, maybe the employee or again shareholders could argue that, why are you giving these funds? And the company would say, the company would not say that these funds are for the cost for a free world or for democracy. They won't say that, and so they would say that I don't know how would they would justify that, but they would say we have to have certain relationship with the ruling party, blah blah blah. But what happens when DPJ is taking over? When DPJ took over the government, I think they have usually not the companies, but the industry association has changed the proportion. When DPJ was in the government, I think the industry association changed the proportion so that DPJ would receive more and LDP would receive less. But to answer your question, I don't really know whether I'm sure the if you're an employee, you would like to see if your company are paying 100 million yen to LDP. If you found out that, you might say that why aren't you paying me myself more?
Okay, we're getting close to break time, but I would like to introduce one more subject before we get to that. and that is enforcement. As you say, there are some rules that politicians must keep when they're looking at their political funding sources from corporations or individuals. In your understanding, who is mandated to watch over politicians' behavior, and how strict is that oversight?
Who is mandated? Well, anyone can see the filings that is filed to the either Ministry of General Affairs or local prefectures electoral administration committee. Anyone can see that. There are usually what happens is that the national media would report whatever is reported. The political organizations have to file by the end of March 31st. Whatever is filed will be made public by the end of October or early part of November. And before making it public, the political electoral administration committee allows media people to see that 2 weeks beforehand, on the understanding that they will not report that before it is made public. And what the media people would do is they would look into whatever is reported and try to find out whatever seems to be illogical or whatever seems to be strange.
So I'm excited here. You're telling us that the media is the primary law enforcement arm of the Japanese government?
Not the law enforcement. They are the primary checkers of the whatever is filed. And so if some of you read Japanese papers, you would notice that by the early part of November or end of October, it is different from where you live. But if you live in Tokyo, maybe it's early part of November. If you live in Kanagawa, it might be the end of October. But if you look at the local area of the newspaper, it's full pages used, and who has raised this much amount of money, whatever.
And other than the media calling attention to it, are there like prosecutors' offices that are looking into these issues regularly, or is it only when something comes out?
I think it's only when something comes out.
Joël Legendre from French TV Radio. I used to follow the parliament for quite many years, and I would like to ask you a question and your opinion about not what the corporation give to the parties or what the people give to the parties, but what the parties give to the people. In other words, you probably heard about the onigiri policies in some meetings in Japan. Just take one onigiri, not two. And in one is a Ichimai note. What do you know about it, and what do you think about the way the people here are bought by parties?
Parties, now I don't think they would give onigiri, by the way. Actually, it's better for you to have your supporters work for you rather than giving them some money, because the simple, it's very simple. If you ask a supporter to put a poster on a board whenever the election is open, you see the posters put on the board. The ideal election that I would like to do is that have, like in my district, I think there's about 1,000 places to post my own picture. These posters can be different. There could be 1,000 different types of posters, because the spaces is directed. You know, you post your poster at one place. So my idea, I haven't done this before, but I would like to do that sometime, is that design a poster with like 70% as being the same, and the rest, 30%, have your supporter write his or her own name and the reason why he or she supports me. And then what would happen is that this person would say, tell your friends about, I have posted this poster at this place. And that's very good campaign method. But if you give some voters some money, they would never tell. So giving someone 10,000 yen is much costly for campaign reasons. If you ask someone to be, you know, voluntarily put a poster, then it's good for he or she to say that. But if you receive...
If I may put that, so basically if they get money...
I have a question for that. Would you agree that there are people specialized in parties to do this job, like in LDP or Minshuto or others?
I don't. Well, maybe beforehand.
Have you ever met them?
No, no. Because, again, it's not... it's not worthy. I mean, if, for instance, in my case, I have to win 100,000 votes. And to win 100,000 votes, it's much economical to have 1,000 people voluntarily put a poster, because and this person would say to 100 friends, is likely to say, not maybe 100, but 20 friends about he or she having put this poster with his or her own sign. But if you give 10,000 yen to one person, he would never say.
But you don't deny that these people exist to tour the countries and encourage voters?
Well, I maybe, but again, it doesn't make sense. And the reason why I say that, it doesn't make sense in the even in the rural area, is because someone that you would imagine would be the person that would be giving out these funds once said that never have your supporters, never take he or she to good Italian and French restaurants. The reason why is that he or she would never tell his friends or her friends about being taken, because they would regard it as given a special treat, and but then it's not very nice to tell to your friends. Mm. But if you were if you have done something for me, then it's easier for yeah.
I see. So if I was to put it in other words, I mean, your supporters will feel proud of doing work for the campaign, but they would feel shameful if they just kind of took some money, and so they would be quiet about it.
Yeah, and people know that it's illegal, and you don't usually talk things that you know that it's illegal to someone. You if
All right.
I mean, it doesn't make economical sense.
All right, so now we're going to cut for a 5-minute break. I guess we'll start again at 7:10. And by the way, this is also a networking event, and this is the prime networking time. So if you have your meishi, maybe he will be happy to exchange meishis for you, especially working journalists. I can tell you I've used him as a source in some of my stories. He's a very, very good person to interview. And also, if you want to go to the bathroom or whatever, it's up to you. But we'll get started again at 7:10. Thank you very much. People are going to slowly filter back in. They're enjoying their break too much. To open the second half, and again, if those, especially in the second half here, feel free to take it in the direction that you want to take it. And if you want to express opinions about what you've heard so far, that's okay too. It's not simply questions in a roundtable. So you can say, this is what I think, and get his reaction if you want. It's up to you. But to open up the second round, as journalists, and this is a question that was similar to what was asked before. As journalists, when we cover politics and issues dealing with money, you know, for example, in the Japanese newspapers, they always say, Seiji Tokane, right? It's one of the big themes of Japanese political reporting. there's always this series of scandals. It goes back maybe to Tanaka Kakaue, right? Ever since that time, there's always one scandal or another scandal. You know, there's the Lockheed scandal, there's the recruit scandal, there's the fan scandal, you know, of, I mean, it's just an endless list. One of the most promising young politicians in the second Abe cabinet was Obuchi Yuko, and now she's gone. And your former political party, the Minanoto, your party, was basically destroyed by a financial scandal. As my first question on this issue, what's going on here? Is the key issue that there is this great deep corruption in Japanese politics, or is it that the rules that are applied to politicians are too vague and people don't know what they're supposed to be doing and they're making mistakes? Or is it that the newspapers are just so hungry to tell a story that they blow up every little thing into a giant issue? You know, obviously there's different cases. Some of those cases are really serious and some are not. But if we're looking at from a systemic point of view, why is it that the newspapers are filled with so many stories about political, financial scandals in Japan?
Why? And that's a good question. Well, I think the each and every scandal is different. Therefore, you can't really categorize which scandal is what. For instance, in case of Yuko Obuchi, I think what has not been asked and what is the most important question is where did the money that was used spent for? That's the most serious question, because apparently what is reported is that there were a big difference in what has been filed as their own report of what has been used and the real amount of money that is left over. And therefore, they had to change so that even though people attending these drama events are really paying, they said that they did not receive these payments and adjust for the missing funds. That is reported, but newspapers are not saying where are these funds used for. And again, maybe it was used as Joel has mentioned, that maybe it was used those were the funds that were given to local people. But I would assume that it's not given to each and every individual. I would assume that if it were given, it would be given to local assembly members as a chunk, not 10,000 yen each to every person, because that's more dangerous. I mean, therefore, those funds may be used after Prime Minister Obuchi has passed away. It may be used so to buy seat for Obuchi to succeed his late father. That kind of thing has to be answered. In case of Mr. Watanabe, the funds were there. I mean, it was not used. But why didn't he return the funds when it was reported? It took more than a month for him to return the funds. That is a question. I mean, maybe there were understanding between the two of them that it was not borrowed funds. It was a given. It might be.
Well, since you've raised that issue, and it was one that I was going to come to later, let's talk briefly about, for the historian's sake, what happened there. I mean, not every journalist in this room actually probably followed the story that closely, but what, in your understanding, as somebody who watched the political party around you kind of take a big hit, what happened? What was that about? What I mean, so far as I know, there was one particular businessman who apparently theoretically donated a very large amount of money to Mr. Watanabe.
Well, what is said is the two of them are saying is that it's not a donation. It was this business person lent the money to Mr. Watanabe. But if the money was there in some banking account, and if the money was there, why did not he return the money? He knew that it will be publicized in the magazine. So why did not he return the money before it was publicized? If he had returned it,
this is a weekly magazine.
Yeah, okay. But if he had returned it, then I think he didn't have to resign. But this was never asked. He didn't say.
So in other words, it's kind of a mystery to you as well.
Yeah, and my guess is that even though the business person says that he had lent the money, it was given money. And it was just between the two of them. And therefore it took some time.
And I've been portraying this, I should say, as something that basically destroyed Minamoto. Is that also your assessment, that basically that one scandal was what brought down the party?
I think the reason Minato was destroyed is not because of that scandal, but he did not answer these questions, and then he suddenly, he did not come to the diet for quite some time, but then he just appeared and then started to say something that was not logical.
Okay. So in other words, his defense, in a way, was worse than what probably happened. But that's often the case, isn't it? I mean, it's usually like, for example, Watergate, they say the same thing. The actual crime was not nearly as bad as the efforts to cover it up, and that's what destroyed Nixon, so right?
That's right, yeah.
All right. Yes, Chris. Microphone, please.
I mean, Michael mentioned Lockheed. I mean, we could go all the way back to shipbuilding in the 1950s, right, if we wanted to. Do you think the system is fixable, or how could we fix it? Make rules more transparent, increase funding so that really political parties or candidates don't have to rely on donations anymore at all? Or do you see that as sort of cost of democracy?
Well, to answer your question, you can divide what is done from those who donate and those who receive the donations. If you look at from the side of from those who donate, if you are a listed company, it's very difficult, I think, to donate a big chunk of money to an individual, because it's very difficult to justify this donation to your shareholders, and also the need from the company side to give that much of amount of money for in return to receive special treatment either in legislation is very small now, and therefore I think big companies are much less eager to donate in big amounts to single individuals. They do give money in the form of buying party tickets, events, but that's not a big chunk of money. So that's not something that you have to worry about. If you are not a listed company, then this story may be different. Compliance and governance of your company is very different, and therefore the situation may be different. if you look at it from the those who receive these donations, the need for a big chunk of money, is that there? No, because there is this new legislation for what was that political support
subsidies
law. Yeah. Political subsidies law, whatever it's for the Seito Kofukin political subsidies law. If that's there, I mean, you would receive if you're LDP 100 or 10 billion yen each year. Then it's to be the to have control over this 10 billion yen is much more important than generating your own funds, and so that probably has changed in some ways. But having said that, I mean, still, in some cases, you might encounter a situation where you would have to raise some funds, and you might rely on someone too much. Then that might be not a good thing.
Well, from the perspective of reform, which I think is at the heart of Chris's question, you know, in the United States' case, there was a very, shall I say, infamous Supreme Court judgment, Citizens United, which basically said that donating money as much as you want is okay because this is free speech. And some a lot of people very, that was a 5-4 decision in the Supreme Court. It was very controversial. And in reaction to that, part of the reform, some of the people calling for reform in the United States are saying, there needs to be a complete separation of money from politics, and this, and that what that means is there needs to be public financing of all political campaigns so as to take all doubt out of the fact that the politicians are working for the people, all of the people, rather than for certain segments of their constituency. Is that a reform that you would support, and why or why not?
You mean that the reform that you have just raised is that electoral funding will be funded by taxpayers' money?
So let's say five candidates register for an election. They are all given an equal amount of money by the public taxpayer money to run their campaign, and may the better man or woman win.
Well, I think that, first of all, if the funds are given, then you would see people running for a campaign just for the sake of you're not wasting your own money, and therefore you're wasting taxpayers' money instead. So that, I think, it will not work. Therefore, you can fund electoral campaign 100%, but if the person that ran for that campaign did not win a certain amount of votes, then you would have to charge him afterwards. But what happens if he is or she is broke? You know, you can't charge him. Therefore, I think it's not workable. And also, the period of campaigning is, I'll say, limited to 2 weeks or so. But what about the activity that you do beforehand? How do you finance that? Are you willing to finance that with all was the taxpayers' money? That's probably impossible. Part of that is financed by taxpayers' money, by political support, supporting bill, or whatever. But it's a subsidy bill.
Yes.
But it's not 100% supported, and therefore.
Well, then let me rephrase the question. Is there any political financing reform, a law that you think should be passed that hasn't been passed?
One law is that if some party says we're not receiving the political subsidies from the government, then it should not be distributed among the rest of the parties, because the calculation is that is based on how much votes you win in national election. And people voting for the Communist Party don't want to give that money or your money to someone else. But you're not reflecting that, Will. So that should be a reform that should be done. That would save, I don't know, 2 billion yen or so.
Anybody want to jump in?
I have a question. This is regarding the bureaucracy versus politicians. So there were stories when Prime Minister Khan was in power that the bureaucracy was not supporting him, not cooperating at all with him, especially during the crisis period. So what do you see as the power balance between bureaucracy and LDP politicians versus other politicians?
Well, bureaucracy basically may go through some sabotage if they don't agree to whatever the minister says. But basically, if you have the general support, even if the bureaucracy sabotages, these things get through. Two examples that I can give you. One is when Prime Minister Koizumi decided to privatize the Postal Service. Of course, the bureaucracy, particularly the Ministry of Postal Service, were against this idea, and therefore they had gone through a lot of sabotage. But once he won the general election in the lower house, that's done. Secondly, I don't think BOJ was really supportive of changing their monetary policy, but once the governor was changed, then it was done. And therefore, if the political leader has the will to go through some changes, and if he has a public support in that change movement, then it will be done, even without the support of the bureaucracy.
My name is Khalil Hassan. I'm ambassador of Bahrain. I find you very interesting. My question is, being LDP, there's a lot of future there. And leaving the LDP, going somewhere else, a smaller party, what's the reason?
He was a member of the DPJ. So basically, just before the DPJ came into power, he left the party. Oh, okay. So he didn't enjoy the 3 years of Seiken Kotai before they were out again. Maybe he had a premonition.
Sorry, thank you.
But it is an interesting question for historical sake. I mean, months before the great landslide election of August 2009, you were one of the most prominent members of the DPJ to leave the party. So
that's right.
Why on earth did you not want to become a minister?
Well, first of all, I was not promised to become a minister. Anyway, but of course, politics, or let me say it this way. My ideal way of running politics is based on reasons and would like to act rationally, basically. However, a lot of the politics or political decision is not made under rational understanding. And therefore, you would have to sometimes... not always, because if you do that always, it's like you're running into accident always. But occasionally, or once in a lifetime, you would have to prove that something that the candidate or the person does may, in a sense, may look irrational. But if there's a story to that, then it works out. That's In other words, I was promised, the then president of DPJ promised me that I would change to the lower house in that district, and I have said to that to the public voters in that district, and therefore I had to keep my words to them.
I see. Well, now that we're kind of getting on the edges of that issue, one of the biggest and probably without a doubt the most consequential financial scandal in recent memory is that of Ichiro Ozawa. Mm-hmm. This, in my view, fundamentally changed Japanese political history. Had Ichiro Ozawa been, I mean, clearly the DPJ was heading towards a landslide victory even with him in charge, and had the prosecutors not come in March of 2009 with those charges, it would have been the much more formidable Ichiro Ozawa who would have led the first DPJ government, not the much more indecisive and weaker Hatoyama. What's your assessment of that? Was this a political plot against Ozawa, as many people say it was? Was it a political plot, yes, but he was also guilty? Or was it completely above board that he did wrong and the prosecutors went after him because he broke the rules and they go after anybody, even the top guy? What's your overall assessment of that affair? Why did this political scandal consume the career of by far the most powerful man?
Was he guilty or not? I don't know. I don't know legally whether he was guilty or not. I don't know. But his former secretary was sentenced to be guilty for receiving the funds.
That's Mr. Ishikawa?
Yeah. Okay. And he has, of course, I would assume that the funds were received, and it was not listed or something like that. I mean, of course, Ozawa may have thought that it was filed or something like that. Did he say it was a borrowed money? Whatever. The funds were given through Ishikawa to Ozawa, or through Okubo to Ozawa, and it turned out to be a piece of land in Akasaka or something like that. The transaction of Ozawa buying a piece of land in Akasaka is legal. I think it's legal, so he can say that he's not guilty, but his secretary was sentenced. His secretary, then member of the parliament, was sentenced. That would, at least, I would think that Ozawa probably knew what was going on. Of course, he can argue that he didn't know that, but.
So you do believe that a crime was likely committed by somebody in his office, or do you dismiss the idea that it was a witch hunt from beginning to end?
Well, I believe that the Supreme Court would not sentence someone if there was nothing there. I mean, and also the funds were, some of the funds were put into Ozawa's safe box or something like that, and then it was turned into a piece of land because he has said and he has admitted that he had bought these lands, piece of land, and he, what was that? He forgot to make a legal document or whatever. That was his argument. But to begin with, The funds came through the hands of Ishikawa and Okubo. Those two people were sentenced. And Ozawa, because of the fact that he is not, this is a real subtle point, but Okubo and Ishikawa probably are the ones whose names are listed on as a someone in charge of filing a political report of these political organizations. Ozawa does not have to file a report on these political organizations. What was filed was false. Therefore, they were sentenced as being guilty. And that part, I don't think that someone had made that up. Therefore, it's did these two person did that for their own sake, or did they do that for under Mr. Ozawa's surveillance? I have no proof that he did that under Mr. Ozawa's surveillance, but it's likely that Ozawa knew.
Well, before Teddy jumps in, Teddy's very knowledgeable about this. So, shoot, yes.
Sure. You know, well, you know, we are very old friends. So, Teddy Jimbo with the VN News. No. The point of the question is: was prosecutor? Do you think prosecutor was politically motivated to implicate Ozawa, given the timing? It was only a few months before the upcoming election, where DPJ is bound to be, you know, with majority and gain control of the government, and even though there may be some element of crime there, but I must say it is a very petty crime, very small crime, and he's a leader of the largest opposition party. He's on his way to the prime minister, and prosecutors came in and implicated him and his secretary, and do you see any trace of political motivation on the prosecutor's part? I think that's the question here.
I don't think the prosecutors were politically motivated. If they were motivated, they were motivated because of the fact of catching a very big figure. I don't think there were any conspiration with the prosecutors and some other bureaucrats, because they've changed the prosecutor's system, but back when Ozawa and his secretary was caught, these prosecutors, their motivation was to catch someone with big names. That is possible. That's probably possible. That was their motivation.
Prosecutors were dying to catch the big fish, but they haven't been able to. And now that once he became prime minister, it almost become impossible for the prosecutors to catch him. So that they'd better do it before he became prime minister. Or
well, I think it was because they had these proofs that the funds were moved, and some of the handling was not 100% clear, and that's why they moved in. The prosecutors and tax authorities maybe was afraid of catching a prime. One example was catching a prime minister was Hatoyama's case. He had received 15 million every month from his mother, and he said he didn't know. Well, do you believe that? It's very difficult to use 50 million. And if you divide that with 30, that's what 500,000 yen every night. I mean, you may be able to use 500,000 yen one night, but if you do that 30 days, you will be unhealthy. You will get sick.
Siegfried, and please introduce yourself.
Siegfried, little freelancer from Germany. I never understood this.
The microphone might not be on. Okay, then speak loudly.
I never understood this system. That the member of the parliament or ministers have a kind of a funding office or kind of funding secretary who deal with the money. And every time it's the politicians say they didn't know because the secretary was responsible for it. I think it's just not something wrong in the whole system said a secretary organizes all what's done with the money from the funds, and is it not?
Okay, go ahead.
Yeah, is it not something wrong in this system that a secretary is responsible for the fund and the politician doesn't know about it? Some people say yes, it's clear they don't know about it. But is there, should not the whole system be changed?
Well. I only know the situation in the United States, but former Ambassador Roos of the United States was in charge of campaign financing of President Obama in California, and not the whole of the United States, from my understanding, which means that. Maybe if you're running for a presidential election in the United States, you have 50 different financing managers alone. And these are, you know, and I don't think Obama knows how, well, he, of course, Ambassador Roos had to report whatever he, the amount of money that he had gathered for campaign purposes. But I don't think President Obama knows, or he had the time to go through and recheck these reports. He probably would have someone check the report for him. And therefore, what I'm trying to say is that it's not just Japan alone that have financing managers. I mean, I don't know, in Europe, for instance, in France, would President Hollande have a financing manager? I mean, he would.
You remember Mr. Juppé, who has to take over the responsibility for Mr. Chirac's. Juppé has had a lot of troubles when he had to, how do you say in English, bear the hat for what happened to Chirac. And we know, I've seen the parties several times in France, we have people who are assigned for any kind of things. And for the specific donation, that happens at a very high level between the political party itself, sometime at the level of general secretary. And you have generous people who are there for that. Of course it happens, and I'm sure in Italy also, very well.
Yeah, okay, I just have an important question for Mr. Asao. Now the LDP and the Kometo controls some two-thirds of the lower house, and Abe seems to think he can do whatever he wants to because they have a big majority. But the actual number of votes that the LDP and Kometo won in the last election combined is actually less than the total number of votes the opposition gained. So what's going on? Why can't opposition get the act together and you know, form a united front? And you mentioned a little bit about Kyosanto. Kyosanto seemed to have modified its political platform somewhat.
Kyosanto's Japan Communist Party?
Communist Party, yeah. They had a very sort of a, you know, stringent, stubborn political position, but now they have modified that. They're now acknowledging the imperial system, and they're not going to, you know, scrap the emperor right after they came into power. So they have modified. So is there any chance that the oppositions can form a united front? Additional question, an independent opposition member like yourself, any chance that you can be sort of like a catalyst to form a united front?
Well, I don't think the Japanese Communist Party would join that national front, but there is a possibility of forming a front or a coalition between the Japan Innovation Party, as they have changed their name, and DPJ. The obstacle is that Mr. Hashimoto and Mr. Governor Matsui, Mayor Hashimoto and Governor Matsui, seems to be, or they have spoken about that publicly. They would favor Prime Minister Abe over Mr. Okada, and so that's the obstacle. I mean, if they win the referendum on the Sunday, I think they would view the victory is due to the support from the cabinet office rather than support from Mr. Okada, because DPJ obviously is against this referendum.
Let me jump in on that point. The polls suggest that Hashimoto is going to lose, and he has said repeatedly that he's going to quit politics. He says, it'll prove that I have no ability in politics and I'm out of here. And assuming that that's true, if Hashimoto resigns from politics in disgust that the people of his district didn't support this plan, which has been the center of his agenda from almost the beginning, and Mr. Kenji Ada presumably will have his own influence within the Japan Innovation Party rise with Hashimoto out of the picture, he seems to be much more DPJ-oriented than LDP-oriented. Could the collapse of Hashimoto in this referendum be the catalyst that does bring those two parties together?
Well, I think the if the outcome were the Hashimoto's victory, then these two parties would not... as I said, in the near future, it will be very unlikely that these two parties would get together. But if they lose, then and if assuming that Hashimoto quits, this would lead to a merger of some part of the Japan Innovation Party and DPJ, and that is leaving the Osaka group from joining the DPJ. The reason why the Osaka group would not join is that because they even if the Hashimoto resigns, they still would have to rely on the popularity of Mr. Hashimoto. Because, again, as I said before, most of the members of the Osaka Restoration Party are former LDP members, not former DPJ members. And they know that they have won their election in the local assembly because of the fact of the mostly relying on the popularity of Hashimoto. They would have to rely on the popularity of Hashimoto because those who are now with Osaka Restoration Party cannot rejoin LDP because local members of LDP are fiercely against this Hashimoto's idea, and therefore they would refuse the former members of LDP rejoining, and therefore. And then could they join DPJ? No, because DPJ also refused Hashimoto's agenda. And is there a future to these people? I think yes, because the local assembly is not SMD, single member district. Local assembly of the Osaka city, you would elect, I don't know, 3 to 6 members. If you look at the prefectural level, some of them are single member district in the prefectural level, but they have won again by fighting against LDP and DPJ in that election. Of course, they may lose in the next election, but if they can't go to either LDP or DPJ, then they would have to stick to that.
Okay, so let me, before we get to Joel, we have 10 minutes left, and are there any questions on political financing or political funds that anybody really wants to jump on before we kind of open it up to anything? anything.
As I said, Michael, listen to what I said. My question is related to that, and it's also related to what you ask.
Excellent.
So what does it cost for politicians to get back to LDP? You remember the case of Kakizawa in the 90s and Funada itself, who now is presiding the constitution reform. Those people have left the LDP in the 90s, 93, I think, and came back later. How much did it cost them, and what does it cost them if it's not just money?
I don't know how much it costs, because I'm not them. Well, it depends, I guess. It depends on if you're not talking about the money, it depends on whether the cost, the political cost, would be how would the voters view. That's the political cost.
Okay.
No.
Suddenly I see three hands go up at once. Why don't we go 1, 2, 3? Okay.
Maybe one comment to this cost. Basically, it doesn't cost these people anything, because if you look at these people in 2005 that left the LDP over Koizumi's postal reform, right? I mean, the LDP took these people back. They only had to sign that they agreed to postal reform, and most of these people were strong enough in the districts to sort of the LDP have them welcome them back, because they defeated assassins, right? My question would be, if you look at the history of the LDP, I mean, the LDP has always been, probably not so much in recent years, but always been a very, very diverse group. Hoshu Honryu, people like Kishi, and party clashed, factions clashed, and there's been a whole lot of ideology, but the party never really fell apart. It's been said that it would fall apart once it's out of power. It hasn't happened, of course. Why is it so difficult for the opposition to actually form a united front, stick together, and accept that, in particular under the current election system, that just everybody doing their own little thing is never going to work against such a formidable opponent?
Well, why is it difficult to form a party that is capable of defeating LDP? Is that your question?
Yes, and basically, to add up on that, I mean, the question, right, is, I mean, it's not only that, of course, the LDP is a very, very formidable opponent. We all know that. But it seems that the opposition keeps shooting itself in the foot by sort of fighting among themselves rather than against the LDP, right?
Oh, that's a very good question. But I think my answer to your question is that members of LDP would value the being in power to be the most important, whereas the members of the opposition favors their own ideal, and the difference in their own ideal or objectives are, if it's slightly different, then they would shoot against each other's foot. That's my observation, at least.
Let me offer you a theory on that. That maybe 60% or so, or 70% of the Japanese voters are in some way conservative, and only about 30% perhaps liberal or progressive. And this means that the LDP, which can occupy the conservative space, can consolidate 40% perhaps of the votes, whereas the opposition parties, all of their unification efforts are hamstrung because they're always a coalition between wings which have nothing in common, those who are from the hard conservative to the quite progressive, that basically the ideological space which the opposition parties are trying to take over is too diverse.
Well, yes and no, I guess. Yes and no. I mean, one example I think it's how you set your agenda. In other words, at least in Osaka, up until I don't know how, what the outcome is, but at least they've won the general election in SMD, single member district, in last election as well. The Osaka Restoration Party or Japan Innovation Party, whatever you call it, they've won more than 50% of the in more than 50% of the electoral districts in Osaka. Why were they successful? They had set their own. Again, most of these people are from LDP, but they know that if they set their agenda well, they can attract votes. Why can't we? So the question would be, why can't we do that nationally? The one example that we've done that nationally is they when LDPJ won. LDPJ said that they said change the government, period, and they did change the government, but they ended with a period. They didn't do whatever the voters wanted them to do after changing the government. That's why they failed. So the next question is, once we change the government, could the new government go through the changes that the actual voters want to see? Mr. Hatoyama had made a mistake in picking the priority when he took over the government. I don't think, and I believe it is true even today, that the majority of the Japanese wanted that the having the bases in U.S. bases in Okinawa moved was the top priority of the new government. I don't think that the majority, maybe if you ask whether you agree to having U.S. bases out of Okinawa or not, maybe more than 50% of the Japanese would say yes. I don't know, but maybe they would say so. But if you ask them, is that the top priority of the new government? I would say less than 1% would say that would be the top priority of the new government. And so he had chosen a policy that was not achievable, and also he didn't succeed in achieving that policy. But he had chosen a policy that was not on the top priority list of the Japanese voters, and that's why he had failed. And so to answer your question, the new government or the new party has to clearly come out with what is the top priority of the voters. And again, if you list three agendas, then you would have yes, 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 or you would have a voter say yes to that and no to that and no to that. So if you increase policies, then the likelihood of voters, dismantling the voters would be greater.
By the way, what are the three priorities?
I don't know. I mean, what I'm saying is that it's easier to say just pick one rather than pick three.
But as a politician, I have an idea.
Today, well, I think today is that the top priority ought to be. How do we go through the decreasing population and growing aging population? That should be the top priority.
Okay, I'm giving the final word to Stefano. Okay.
Yes, very quickly. The next upper house elections next year are supposed to be very important, because if Giminto will manage to gain two-thirds of the overall seats, so Abe will press ahead with the constitutional revision. So how many chances do you see that Abe will gain the two-thirds of the overall seats and so will be able to change the constitution?
Well, I don't think Abe would gain two-thirds by LDP alone, period. I mean, there's no chance. The reason behind that is that for the election of the upper house, you have 48 seats in the proportional. And let's see. I would have to quickly calculate because it's let's see, you have in districts, but these in prefectural level, but these 73 includes metropolitan Tokyo, which has 5 seats, and it is impossible for the reasons that Mr. Jimbo said, for LDP to win 2/3 of the proportional district, because they've never won 2/3 votes. And the maximum they can win is probably 40% of the proportional district. That is the maximum. I would say they would win less than that. So 48 times 40, 0.4 would come out with their outcome in the proportional. It is impossible for LDP to win 3 seats out of 5 in Tokyo. The maximum would be 2. And therefore, it is impossible for LDP alone to win 2/3. And I would assume that it is also impossible for LDP combined with Komei Party, which is slightly against changing Article 9 and changing some of the constitutional changes. I would assume that it is difficult for LDP combined with Komei to win 2/3 of the upper house. And the reason behind that is the electoral system is much different than that in the lower house. The lower house, you have 295 seats for single members district, and you have 180 for proportional. So it's easier for LDP combined with Komeito to win 2/3 of 295. And so if you have 200 out of 295, and it might be easier for them to win 80 seats or even 100 out of 180. Well, 100 out of 180 is difficult, but 80 seats is easy. So that would leave them with 280 out of 475. That's not 2/3, but if they are lucky, they may raise the proportion as they have today, that have more than having more than 320 or so, and they have more than 2/3 in the lower house. And the simple reason is that the weight of single member district is much higher in the lower house than in the upper house. And if it's a single member district and if you have many oppositions, it's easier for the ruling party to win. And that's why it's easier for them to win 2/3 in the lower house, and the reason why they know that they cannot win 2/3 alone, and that's why I think they are supporting Japan Innovation Party, or at least Osaka Restoration Party in this referendum, or the cabinet is supporting, or the cabinet minister is supporting.
Let me just clarify one last point before we wrap up. I got it that you say it's impossible for them to get the 2/3 majority with LDP and Komeito. What are the prospects of them, LDP, Komeito, plus a few ideological allies and other parties? Is that impossible? Is it a long shot? Is it doable? What's your assessment?
I think it's doable.
So you think they could be in range of revising the Constitution?
Yes, yeah.
How many do you think NDP are for the...
Mike.
How many of the DPJ members do you think is for the constitution revision, or would they actually support that?
The members of the lower house, some members of the lower house are supportive of constitutional reform, but I think there are very few members in the upper house supportive of the constitutional change. Probably, yeah.
All right. Well, regrettably, we could probably spend another 2 hours and learn profitably many new things, other things about Japanese politics. But I guess they want to ask you, what's your stance on Article 9?
Oh, okay. Article 9. Well, from reading Article 9, I don't think the self-defense forces can be justified. And my view is that we would have to have either the right to defend, self-defense should be written, or the fact that we have self-defense forces should be written. And when I say that, people who are against changing Article 9 would argue that if you change Article 9, the reality would move more forward. But since we have an Italian friend here, I understand there's a chateau in Pisa, which is like this. My argument is that if you change Article 9, you would have the self-defense forces in alignment with the Constitution. That's my argument. But people against the changing Article 9 is that if you change Article 9, then the reality would move forward, even forward with this, like the chateau moving, the chateau itself moving towards right. But as a lawmaker, I would like to have a constitution in line with the reality.
Okay, that's a pretty clear answer, I think. Well, this is the end of our fifth political roundtable. First of all, I'd like to give a warm thank you to this man who endured our questions. And I believe this is his third yearly honorary membership to our club. Now, he told me the first time he received one, he kind of had it and he liked it and he put it in the drawer and he never used it. But the second time he kind of came and said, you know what, this time I'm going to make use of it. And in fact, in this very room, he had one of his party conferences when you were Minamoto,
yes,
right? When you were your party.
Yeah.
So he's actually somebody who does make use of honorary memberships. And so we may see him around.
All right.
And always a pleasure. Thank
okay,
you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
And that concludes our event for tonight. Thank you for coming.
Thank you.